Welcome to What Are You Sporting About podcast, a podcast about business, employment, sports, and entertainment to help educate, support, and guide you to your next level. Here's your host, attorney Savania DeBarros.
Hi, and welcome to this episode of What Are You Sporting About. Today, we have with us Renee Montgomery, who's a current WNBA player, TV host, and commentator, and also business owner. Hi, Renee.
Hello there. Thank you for having me on this nice, lovely podcast.
No, thank you so much. It is people like you who we're trying to reach out so that we can share a breadth of information with other athletes who are in business or entertainers or whomever so that they can get the advice that they need to be successful. So let's just jump into it. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Okay, so I grew up in West Virginia, and there are Black people there, my family. I went to high school out of my district. We ended up winning 3 championships. I ended up being an All-American, went to UConn, won 2 championships there, got drafted. But I say that to say it's a very bizarre start, right, that I grew up in West Virginia, and so that's like what makes me me. I grew up in a small town and you had to be really creative. Like, you know, it just, you had to create your own fun, playing in the woods, imagination. Right. And those type of things are what helped me now in my post-basketball life, because it's the creativity and the imagination that people are like, well, how'd you think of that? So I would say growing up in West Virginia kind of shaped who I am, is how I had to, you know, and even, you know, everybody hears country stuff, but even just figuring out ways to do something, like figuring out problems, you know, that people like that are working with their hands and stuff are more accustomed to that. So I would say West Virginia shaped me.
You know, it's funny you say that, because I'm born and raised, was born and raised in Florida. And the city that I grew up in is Gainesville. Shout out to all my Gainesville folks.
Okay.
So, but you know, I remember growing up literally like nothing but woods around us. Of course, they've developed a lot now around the area, but there was, like you said, there was nothing but your own creativity, time, and space to really be innovative as kids. And I didn't really realize how entrepreneurial I was until I got into business.
Honestly, I'm glad you said that. I think there's a direct correlation. I really do.
It is. So tell me, connect the dots for me about you growing up in West Virginia in the country, having that experience, and now coming into your own as a mother, a business owner, a professional athlete. What experiences have you been able to look back on, you know, because hindsight is 2020. Yes. And really realize that that gave you a foundation for who you are now and what you're achieving.
I would say one of the first things that pops out in my mind when you say that is my family dynamics. My family is, I never understood, like, as I started getting older, my family, literally everything revolved around me. So as I'm young, I don't even realize it. You know, like, we're going to AAU trips. We're doing all kinds of different things that are very expensive. Mm-hmm. And also, it's time consuming. So my sisters, we didn't have family vacations anymore. And my sisters, I have 2 older sisters. They never complain. So growing up under that type of environment, looking back as an adult, it makes me appreciate where I am, because I understand that my whole family made a sacrifice for the life I'm living now. So that to me was kind of like, as an adult, you realize it, but when you're a kid, it's just like, yeah, we're going here, we're going there. And nothing. And you don't realize that that stuff costs money.
Okay? A lot of money.
And a lot of money. So my whole family was making a sacrifice for like a 12-year-old kid. And to me, I don't think I would want to do that, but they did it. And obviously I did end up making it to the pros, but they made that sacrifice like blindly. So that's why I said hindsight, of course, they're like, if anybody's listening, like, of course they did it. They knew you were good. It's 1% of college athletes go to the WNBA. Right. That's the hardest league statistically to get in. Mm-hmm. So for my parents to bet on me in West Virginia at that young of an age, it's like they had that 2020 hindsight, but they didn't.
Right. They knew that the investment was crucial for you. And they probably just felt like, if this is something that my daughter really is enjoying and she's passionate about it and she's working hard, like she's really putting in the work, why wouldn't we help her in that? Because maybe exactly. that is the line that she, you know, the path that she's going to take.
Exactly. Yeah.
You know, I actually had an opportunity to go and compete in track and field in Australia. And
that's awesome.
I had, not so quite. Hold on 1 second. So I had an opportunity to go to London for cheerleading as well. But unlike your parents, my parents could not afford the bills. So yeah. And it's so funny because sometimes when I look back on that too, I wonder, and I always think like, what would have been my sporting career?
What if that happened?
Yeah. So that's
and
amazing.
And that's why I say as an adult, because as a kid, you kind of just don't really think about money. It's just not something you say, can I go to the class trip?
Right.
You don't care that it costs $100. Your parents are like, oh my goodness, we're broke, you know?
Right.
But that, like as a kid, I've never thought about money. But now as an adult, looking at how expensive traveling is, I'm just like, wow.
Yeah. And it's way much more now than when we were kids. So
absolutely.
Imagine when your kid is getting older and competing.
I'm gonna have to talk to a lot of people.
Hey, I'm gonna need you to go ahead and donate over here, please.
My goodness.
So I want to talk to you though about your journey leading up to the pros and how you handled that transition from the collegiate level to the pros. And how you're able to balance being a mother and a professional athlete.
Yeah, so I think if there's one university that you can go to that can best help you prepare for the pros, is UConn. And I say that because UConn operates like a pro team. Coach Ariema, you come in there as a high schooler and you're young and dumb, and they don't give you the excuse that that's okay. Mm-hmm. So, you know, a lot of times people say, no, it's okay. They're young. They're learning. They don't know yet. It's not like that at UConn. That's not how we do it here. You're going to do it this way. So when you go into UConn and you have to meet the standard, it really helped me because I didn't have an option to be a freshman. I was starting when I was a freshman. So I didn't have the option to take the back seat and watch how things went. And I took that same approach and that same mindset when I went to the pros. I don't have the luxury to take a sit back and survey and fill out the situation. So I kind of went into the situation just eyes wide open and ready to learn. I think a lot of people assume that because, you know, I went to UConn and my team that year had went undefeated. I didn't go in like arrogant. I went in confident, but I didn't go in like, yeah, my team was undefeated and I'm this and that. Like, I really went in there with like an eagerness, I would say. So I think that my mindset going into the pros helped because the vets, I think, realized that that was my mindset. You could tell. And so they like a lot of vets just took me under their wings in the sense that they accepted me right away. Ones that I didn't even know, but I think they just appreciated that I was young and respectful.
Nice. I love it. You said a term that is so crucial to being a successful athlete, whether it's collegiate level, professional level, or as a business owner. You mentioned having a mindset. You had to make sure you had the proper mindset. And in the book, What Are You Sporting About? That is one of the key topics that I touch on for professional athletes in business to help them develop the right mindset around being an athlete, what that entails, but also being able to take that experience from the pros and use that in business, but having to shift that mindset in a way to actually operate their business.
I just realized
the proper way.
I actually just realized something. Obviously, is your book out yet? I don't know. I haven't read
it. Not yet. June 1st.
Okay. So do you know that your book is literally the whole mission statement of my foundation? So I have a foundation.
Get out of here. Wow.
As you were saying it, I was like, okay, this is kind of bizarre. My foundation mission statement is to teach people the skill set I learned on sports because they translate to everyday life. Like that's the mission statement of my foundation. When I say my foundation, I mean the Renee Montgomery Foundation. Yeah. I created one. It's crazy because you made a whole book about it. I made a book, there is a point here that I believe it actually works.
Yes. Yes. So you know what? That's a great segue. Tell us about this foundation, because I was looking at this information and I said, okay, this is an amazing thing that Renee is doing for athletes or whomever so that they can have proper leadership skills, mindsets around business,
exactly,
education. And actually, before you answer that question, there's a quote that I found on you.
And yes, I hope it's my favorite life motto. I hope
it probably is. Okay. It probably is. But it says, athletes are going to be responsible for educating themselves. When it's your business, your name's on it, then you have to take ownership of it. The information is out there. And if something goes wrong, it's going to be on you. That's actually something that is also in What Are You Sporting About, but in a different way. Because there is a lot of information available. There are now, I feel like, a lot of people like you and I who are creating avenues or collaborations to bring more education to professional athletes or people who are surrounded by them or connected to the industries so that these individuals can have the right education, guidance, and support that they need to be successful. So tell us about your foundation and how you're implementing these different things to support athletes.
I love it. So that was not the quote that I thought you were going to say, even though that is a quote. I thought you were going to say, a lot of people associate me with the quote, "It's a good day to have a good day."
And people
associate that with me because I'm going into my 12th WNBA season. So I've been here a long time. Mm-hmm. And that eagerness that I talked about my rookie season, mm-hmm. I still have it. And I still have that like level of positivity and optimism. And people can't understand it. Like they're like, you're 33. You've been in the league long. Like, you know, I haven't had like the easiest road and people can't understand like why I'm so positive and everything. But I think it's a mindset. I literally think if I decide to wake up today and even if I don't feel good, mm-hmm. I say, it's a good day to have a good day. Like it's literally just tell myself like, let's just have a good day regardless. Cause people like, well, you don't feel bad after the games and hurt. I'll be telling my teammates, yes, I'm hurting too. Like, what are you? Yes, I played the same amount of minutes as you. I'm tired too, boss. But they don't understand that. Like, just because you're tired, like I don't tell myself I'm tired. I tell myself, all right, let's go. Let's get it. Right. Like, you know, I just choose not to. So that aspect, I try to carry it over. I'm like, people need to understand that they can control their lives. Right. And when I have like foundation events, one of the events I have is called Let's Go Pro. And in West Virginia, I talked about West Virginia, but West Virginia has no pro sports, no NBA, NFL, MLB, nothing. And a lot of cities don't, but mm-hmm. the whole state of West Virginia has nothing. And I know a lot of them don't. And I, for me as an athlete growing up, that's a mm-hmm. heavy blow. Like
it
like,
is.
So the Let's Go Pro is a event where I bus 55 people from West Virginia to Atlanta let them experience the big city per se. And Lenox mm-hmm. Mall, they thought Lenox Mall was like the craziest thing they've ever seen in a sense, because even in Charleston, we barely have a mall now. Only 3 stores are open. So I think that once you open people's eyes to a different world and mm-hmm. a different life, like if you literally, I hope somebody listening just literally listens and like, okay, I guess I do have a choice, because like it's a habit. So right. I think everything you do is a habit. So while all those people were here, I let them realize you didn't think about complaining, right? Because that's mm-hmm. when things are going good. Keep Correct. That same energy. Keep that same energy when things are going bad, though. Don't just right. melt down and break down.
Right. And, you know, one thing I love that you said, you know, about the quote, it's a good day to have a good day. And you may be tired coming from a long, hard game, but there's also an opportunity in everything. And even from a pro standpoint, you have an opportunity that millions of people fight for from Pop Warner leagues.
Exactly. We are the 1% that made it.
Right. That made it. And so you have to create and maintain the proper mindset to appreciate the opportunity that you're in. And then also too, just looking at what we're going through as a nation in this pandemic season, a lot of people are, you know, upset because they can't go certain places, they can't do anything, but there's been so much opportunity and space through this pandemic. It's all about a mindset.
Yes. And so for me, honestly, the pandemic changed my life. And I would say, like, in a good way.
Yeah.
Before the pandemic, I was doing all analyst work. And this is going to sound bizarre, but I was doing all kinds of broadcast work, ESPN, NBA TV, Fox Sports South. I was calling the NBA G League Finals before that got canceled. I was going to call the NCAA Women's Tournament before that got canceled.
Oh, wow.
I was going to call the Dos Equis 3x3 before that got canceled. So there was a lot of different things. I was calling Hawks games, NBA games, and all of that got shut down, right? Because everything got shut down.
Right.
So when that happened, I've always kind of wanted to get into other type of entertainment where I'm interviewing people, I'm talking to crowds. So I just looked at this opportunity where everything shut down, I can focus on me. Mm-hmm. And I started doing these interviews on my Instagram and just interviewing different people in my network. Obviously, I know like some celebrities. So I reached out to them. And honestly, it's taken off. And this series like got sponsored by, I have a sponsor now.
That's really cool.
And it was like, I wanted to be, and I'm putting air quotes around it, but the talk show host, you know, like, so basically I got to just create my own thing. And I know I wouldn't have done that if the pandemic didn't happen.
That's amazing. And look, you're talking to another person who has started a podcast.
And that's why I told you congratulations. Y'all didn't hear that when we first got on the phone, but that's why I said, girl, congratulations.
I was not going to do a podcast. I just felt like it's way too many things for me to do. And it was just something that was always in the back lurking around. Cause I just knew a year ago, I was like, I know I'm probably going to have to start a podcast at some point because, you know, that's the thing to do. But the issues or topics that I cover in What Are You Sporting About the book, I said to myself, I can't stop this conversation right at the last page. So we need to do a podcast. And it's been amazing because now, of course, with the pandemic, people are available. And
very available.
I'm trying to fill time.
Very available. I've been trying to reach out to everybody right now because, you know, as soon as everything starts moving and going again,
it's going
to
be crazy.
Oh, it's going to be crazy. Everybody's going to be trying to get their own life back on track.
Yes, yes. I have to ask you, though, Renee, because I see you doing a whole lot of stuff. And I know that some of your shows or whatever that you were supposed to be doing were canceled. But in a regular day, or let's just say a regular month, how do you manage it all?
Yeah. I think I'm oddly disciplined. That's how I would explain it. I have this thing about it. I don't usually push things off. So if somebody sends me an email, like right when you sent me the email and said this is the time, I put it in the calendar immediately. Like I try to do like whatever the task is that I receive, I try to respond back immediately, because I think once you start pushing stuff off to later, that's when things start getting piled up. So I try to make sure that like I don't have a whole day where I just let things pile up crazy. Like and I don't know, it to me, I like that. Obviously you have to stay in tune with your phone a lot.
Right.
But I just don't let things get piled up, and I always try to live in the now.
Yeah.
So if I'm playing, if I'm working out, so pre-pandemic, literally 1 week before the pandemic happened and we had to quarantine, one of my mornings was I had to wake up at 6 a.m. because I had a 9 a.m. photo shoot. Mm-hmm. I had a photo shoot from 9 to 11. Then I went home, changed, got something to eat, went from NBA TV from 2 to 5, and I hosted the NBA TV update segment. Right after that, I drove to the Gateway Center Arena to call the NBA G League game for the Skyhawks. That was from 7 to 9. And then after that, I went and played pickup from like 11 to 1. And that was like a real day. And that wasn't even crazy to me. That's how my schedule started to be.
I have no idea how that wasn't crazy to you, because I'm like, huh?
Because that was my normal Wednesday. Like that.
Okay.
That was my normal Tuesday. I'm sorry. On Tuesdays, like, so I didn't do NBA TV every day of the week. I did it on Tuesdays. So I know on Tuesdays, that's my long days.
Right.
And now that the pandemic hit, I'm like, there's no way I could do Tuesday. Like, I've gotten so accustomed to just like, okay, I got to go. All right, babe, I'm going to get up and go do an interview in the living room, you know, right. Like I've gotten accustomed to that Tuesday seems like it's impossible now.
Yeah. You know, one thing I will say this for anyone who's listening is, regardless whether we're in a pandemic or anything else crazy happens, the biggest lesson I've learned so far is to basically put myself first, just like you. Like, you've created a schedule that works for you now. And one thing that bothered me, because, you know, once you're an athlete, always an athlete.
Yep.
You know, I can kind of make my husband hurt himself one year. He tried to raise him. Like, look, I'm like, dude, look, sidetrack for a second. Yeah. I'm like, dude, listen, muscle memory.
They don't get it. They don't get it.
But, you know, so after having my son, and we live so far now, I just got so wrapped up into this whole schedule of being a mom, a lawyer, this travel, you know, then coming home and trying to make dinner, whatever. I was not setting myself up for success personally. And I missed working out. And one of the things the pandemic gave me was time to clarify my schedule and, you know, time to get organized with meals. So now we meal prep and everything, you know, but of course it's always about a mindset.
Yep.
So, give me, or give them, whoever's listening, give some of our athletes or entertainers, business owners, a tip that they can take with them to create their own success and maintain that in whatever industry that they're in.
I would say always live in the now. Like, you learn it in sports. We call it a short-term memory in sports. If you have a turnover and you're thinking about the turnover, you're probably going to make another mistake. So that concept, I think, is life. And a lot of times, like, if you're in a rut or whatever, don't soak in your rut, like, live in the now. So if you have to go to school that day, go to school. Get yourself out of the rut by living in the moment is how I would say, because everything's not going to go great. But if I'm at practice thinking about what's going to happen to NBA TV, and then when I'm at NBA TV, I'm thinking about how bad I practiced because I was thinking about it. You see how that's just not... Yeah. That's not a good cycle. So if you could learn to just separate things, like if you're going to be with your family, be with your family. Don't be thinking about work and worried about work when you're with your family, because your family can feel that you're thinking and worrying about that. So just live in the now.
I absolutely love it, Renee. Thank you so much for being here and pouring out knowledge and fun with us today.
Thank you for having me. This was nice. I like it.
It was really good. We're going to have you back.
Okay.
Yes. All right.
I'm sure I'll be once an athlete, always an athlete. So always. I'll be an athlete then.
Yes. All right. Thank you so much.
No problem. Thank you.
Thanks for joining us this week on What Are You Sporting About podcast. Make sure to visit our website, prosportlawyer.com, where you can subscribe to the show in iTunes, Stitcher, or whatever your favorite platform is, so you'll never miss a show. And while you're at it, if you found value in the show, we'd appreciate a rating on iTunes or iHeartRadio. Or if you'd simply tell a friend about the show, that would help us out too. If you like the show, you might want to check out our book, What Are You Sporting About? Attorney Savania DeBarros is available for private consulting at sldebarros.com. And remember, we're here to educate, support, and guide you in your journey to success, because we're all sporting about something.